Hi students, so in the previous video we have already seen about some of the questions related to model paper 2 class 10 science Karnataka state syllabus. We'll be continuing here with the model paper 2 itself with the rest of the questions and try to understand more about the questions that has been asked. So let's start with it. What is substitution reaction? So this is a continuation of the previous video. So if you have missed watching the previous video, just look back the previous video, then you can come back to here. So substitution reaction is a single displacement reaction, like a metal displaces another metal or a metal displaces another non-metal, which is of in the higher reactivity series. So it is a chemical reaction during which a functional group is to replace another functional group. That is known as substitution reaction. So answer the following questions. So next one, the compounds C2H4, C3H6, C4H5, C5H10 are homogeneous series. Why? So here you can see that continuous numbers of the C's here, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So what is the general name and general formula of these carbon compounds? So you can see that a series of organic compounds containing characteristics of functional group and a successive member differ from each number. So it is C2H4 is ethylene, that is, or ethene. Ethene is double bond. So next is propene, butene, pentene. It comes under unsaturated carbon compounds having double bond. It is also known as alkenes. Next question, the atomic number of an element is 20. In which period of the modern periodic table would this element be placed? Why? How will you decide whether the element is a metal or a non-metal? So here, the element having atomic number 20 is placed in group 2. So you need to be perfect with the periodic table and its elements, with the group and the periods. Otherwise, it will be very difficult to solve this problem or the question. So it comes under group 2 and 4th period of periodic table, and the element, it is known as calcium. So the metals from the left of the line and non-metals are at the right of the line. The elements immediately adjacent to the line are known as the metalloids. So from the left it is the metals, from the right it is the non-metals. In between these two are the metalloids. So adjacent line it is the metalloids. So next question, what is a metal oxide called? Why it is known as a basic oxide? Name the products obtained when copper oxide reacts with dilute hydrochloric acid. So metal oxides, they are also known as basic in nature because they react with dilute acids more to form salt and water. Like copper oxide CO plus hydrochloric acid gives rise to copper chloride plus water. That is, copper chloride is a salt and water is released. So copper oxide dissolves in mineral acids such as hydrochloric acid. So copper oxides can dissolve in hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid or nitric acid to give the respective copper salts. So next question, draw the diagram of arrangement of apparatus showing the reaction of zinc granules with dilute sulfuric acid and testing hydrogen gas by burning it. So you just need to draw the diagram and mark the zinc granules and delivery tube. So it is the test tube and you have the zinc granules here and with dilute sulfuric acid in it. And you have a rubber cork so that the gases do not escape from here. So metal plus acid, it will give rise to gas. What is the gas that has been released with the pop sound? It is hydrogen gas. So the bubbles that is released here, it is a hydrogen gas and you can hear a pop sound. So the next is, explain the cleaning action of soaps. Most of the dirt in oil is in nature. So oil does not dissolve in water. So oil directly will not get dissolved in water. So dirt and oil will be together and it cannot be dissolved in water. So it's hydrophobic ends of molecule of soap constituents that consists of sodium or potassium salts of long chain carboxylic acids. So here in soaps, the carbon chain dissolves the oil and ionic end will dissolve in water. So carbon chain dissolves in the oil and the other end, that is ionic end, will dissolve in water. Thus it removes the dirt. Next is draw the diagram of apparatus used in the electrolytic refining of copper and label the following. You need to label the cathode and just anode mud. It's not the anode, it's the anode mud. So it's electrolytic refining of copper. You can see that whatever metal you need to extract or refine, that particular solution you will be metal and salt solution you will be using. Here it is copper, it is the copper sulfate solution, or you can see here that copper, the impure metal will be at the anode, and when you pass the electricity here through the solution, the pure only metal will go and attach to the cathode here. That is also a pure metal. So you can see that remaining waste material will get deposited at the down and it is known as the anode mud. So next question, explain the formation of ionic compounds magnesium chloride with the help of an electron dot structure. So here magnesium reacts with chlorine by losing two electrons, and on the other hand chlorine reacts by gaining the electron that is lost by the magnesium. Magnesium loses the electron here and chlorine will gain the electron, and this results in the formation of magnesium chloride. So here one will lose the electron, one will gain the electron. So magnesium loses and chlorine will gain, and togetherly they form the magnesium chloride. Next question is, write the chemical balanced equation of reaction of aluminium metal with steam. So balanced equation of aluminium metal with steam is Al, so aluminium, steam is again water. So Al plus H2O gives rise to, so 2Al plus 3H2O gives rise to Al2O3 plus 3H2. So this is a balanced equation. So you can see that Al is 2 here, Al is 2 on the other side, left hand side and right hand side are equal here. So hydrogen is 6, and you can see hydrogen is 6 on the other side. Oxygen is 3, oxygen is 3 here. You can see that your equation is balanced. So next, coming to the biology part C, the materials that change slowly their form and nature are, so they are wasted, that is plant fiber materials. So next, the pattern of response in the roots of plant. The roots of plant is directional and negatively phototropic. That is, roots are away from the sunlight and they are directive, and it is negatively phototropism or away from the sunlight. Mention the reason for the depletion of ozone layer. So we need to say that why ozone layer is getting depleted. So here the chlorofluorocarbon is only the reason. The gases that is found in the sprays, refrigerators, etc., they are released into the atmosphere. This causes the depletion of the ozone layer, that is O3. Name any two ancient systems that were practiced to harvest rainwater. So you can write collection of water in ponds and construction of small earthen pots. So the next question is, how is oxygen rich blood iron is supplied than all this to the cells in the body. So iron rich blood is supplied to all the parts of the body. Here we can say that right ventricles pumps the blood from the right atrium to the lungs to the rich oxygen. There you can see from the lungs the carbon dioxide is removed out and you breathe in oxygen, and you can see that oxygenated blood that is received from the lungs comes to the left atrium and receives the blood from the lungs to the left atrium, and it is rich in oxygen. So it is then pumped to the left ventricle and that from there the left atrium is supplied through the aorta to different parts of the organs where the oxygen rich blood is taken in. And there you can see that the cells utilize these oxygen and release out cells and tissues in their functions. They take in oxygen and release the carbon dioxide, and again the same process is repeated here. So next question. The people who live in and around the forest are said to be the stakeholders of the forest. Why? Explain. So people who live in and around, they are called as stakeholders because they are dependent on the forest produce or the forest materials as the raw materials. So they cut off some of the branches of the trees and pluck their leaves, but they do not cut down the complete set of tree or the whole tree. They also collect a green fodder and also graze their cattle in the forest. So next is, draw the diagram showing the germination of pollens on stigma and label only female germ cells. So you can see that pollens once fall on the stigma, so it forms a long pollen tube and gets fused at the germ cell with the germ cell. And you can see that you just need to mark the ovary or the female germ cell. So female germ cell is the one main thing you need to mark here. Next, how do genes control and express the tall and the short traits in plants? So characteristics of plant height, that depends on the particular hormone. It depends on a particular hormone, but either it depends on the efficiency of the process making it. The enzyme will be responsible for the production of such hormone, and you can see that these enzymes will alter certain enzymes to make it less efficient and less effective, and certain plants will become short because less amount of hormones are released here, and more amounts of hormone are released, then there will be tallness in the plant. So either it is known as dwarfism or gigantism. Next question, in female reproductive system, how does an egg from the ovary reach uterus of and develops into a fetus? Here, a pregnancy will start with fertilization process when a woman's egg joins with the man's sperm, and this is known as fertilization. Finally occurs by the development of embryo, and it occurs in the fallopian tube, and it is linked to the ovary and the uterus. And if fertilized egg travels down the fallopian tube and comes to the uterus, the embryo starts growing in the uterus. So next, what are the changes that occur in the uterus for development of the fetus? So what happens during pregnancy is, the lining of the uterus gets thickened and it is rich in blood supply, and it provides good nourishment to the fetus or the growing baby. As the pregnancy progresses, the uterus expands according to the fetus. So next, draw the labeled diagram showing the structure of nephron. So you need to draw the tubular part of the nephron and connect the veins, branched renal veins and capillaries to it. So it helps in, it is the filtration, ultrafiltration unit of the kidney here. So next question is, how do homologous characteristics in different organisms help to identify the evolutionary relationships? So four limbs of human, so answer is four limbs of humans, birds are homologous. They have some structure and design development that is very much similar to the humans, and the birds are relevant, but they have almost different functions and appearance. Homologous organs helps to understand the organism that has evolved from common characteristics of two different species. Here you can see that bird uses the four limbs to make preparation for the flight, but humans use it for walking. Walking, jumping, sitting, running, etc. So next question is, how do Mendel's monohybrid cross experiment clarify that traits of an organism independently inherits the progenies? So Mendel's crossed pea plants have round green seeds, that is RR YY as the dominant. So ground green seeds, round is dominant here, green is recessive. With pea plants, wrinkled yellow. So wrinkled is recessive and yellow is dominant. So the crossed pea, both pea plants have single contrasting character, which is known as monohybrid cross. So it is single characteristics, that is either it might be round green seeds or wrinkled yellow seeds, or you can see that tall and dwarf, that also can be taken as a characteristics of monohybrid cross. But RRYY and small r and y is a characteristic of a dihybrid cross. Next, name the mineral required for the production of thyroxine hormone. What is the use of this hormone to our body? So iodine is very important for the thyroxine gland to make thyroxine hormone. It regulates, what does it regulate? It regulates the carbohydrates, proteins, fat and metabolism in the body. It controls all these metabolism in the body and provides the balance of for our regular growth. What are involuntary actions? Name the parts of human brain that controls the voluntary and involuntary actions. So involuntary actions are those actions which are not in our control but will not stop. That is like heart, heartbeat, lungs, breathing, digestion, etc. process. So you can see that medulla controls the involuntary actions and cerebrum controls the voluntary actions. So that's all about the model paper 2 question paper. So we have completed both the sets of model papers. So hope you all have understood these 2 question papers. Do watch the videos and practice at home. Thank you all for watching.